I get a lot of comments asking me if it's tough to pick just 10 songs every year when so much shit gets released. The answer? No, not really. There's a lot of mediocre garbage that comes out every year, but it takes something really god-awful for it to make the list of the 10 worst songs of the year. Man, I can't wait to hear him tear into Pharrell's Happy. Get ready to be disappointed, it's not on this list. Nor is Jason Derulo's Talk Dirty or Wiggle. Are they stupid, repetitive songs? Sure. But I've got 10 that are way worse than those mediocre yawn fests. These are the songs that really stood out from the rest of the shit that claimed the title of the 10 worst songs of 2014. Number 10. Mike Posner featuring Big Sean, Top of the World. At this time next year, released at the end of 2013, Mike Posner's latest attempt to create something as popular as Cooler Than Me didn't really start getting airplay until 2014, which is why it's eligible for this year's list. It's an interesting take on rap boasting. Instead of talking about what he has, he's predicting what he will have, and that he'll be on top of the world this time next year. Well, it's this time next year. How we doing, Mikey? Is it? Apparently not. This song didn't chart, it didn't get any certifications, it only got airplay because the aforementioned Cooler Than Me was big 4 years ago and people thought, well, this might be a hit too. Another hit, excuse me while I run the bases. Another hit? Nah, you might have connected, but you grounded out to first on this one. After this, I think the coach will put in a pinch hitter for you. Whatever you want, but I'm not gonna keep my feelings to myself. This voice is smooth? It's fucking grating. If this song was sung by anybody else, it probably wouldn't be awful enough to make this list. But add these ridiculous lyrics with the noise coming out of his face, and you got yourself a song bad enough to make the 10 spot. At this time next year, I'm having enough to buy the whole damn thing. As I said, it's this time next year. And it looks like you didn't quite make it back to the top of Mount Relevancy. Try the climb again next year, I guess. Number 9. Paramore. Ain't It Fun. Ain't it fun? Living in the real world. Hayley Williams will be 26 years old in December 2014. In 2007, Paramore's song Misery Business topped charts all across the world. And since then, Paramore has been a fairly well-known name, raking in money year after year. This started 7 years ago, so Hayley Williams would have been 19, probably 18, when that song came out. Don't go crying to your mama, 'cause you're on your own in the real world. Who the fuck is Hayley Williams to talk about the real world? She's lived in a fantasy world for her entire adult life. Never had to get a real job, never had to worry about money, she can do whatever she wants, whenever she wants. Her only real worry in the world? If they cancel the shade of red hair dye she uses. The only way this song would have any redeeming qualities is if she's singing this song to her future self, to remind her to try and at least stay somewhat grounded, when she inevitably goes the Gwen Stefani route by leaving her bandmates behind and starting a pop career. She's already on her way. The song's lyrics are insanely repetitive. This song could be 3 minutes easily, but they somehow managed to stretch it out to 5. In fact, after the 1 minute 23 mark, the only line that's not a repeat from that first minute and a half is the words, "Baby, now you're one of us." Which again, you're not one of us, Hayley. Not even fucking close. No cool instrumentals or solos to justify this being 5 minutes long. It just feels like it keeps going until someone said, okay, so we don't know how to end this, so I don't know, just fade it out before this becomes 8 minutes long and no radio station wants to play it. Number 8 is a tie between Taylor Swift, Shake It Off, and Demi Lovato featuring Cher Lloyd, Really Don't Care. Both of these songs were essentially written with the same motivation. I'll show the haters slash boys who fucked me over slash people who didn't believe in me. I'm gonna spend weeks writing and recording a song and then creating a music video to tell them that I don't care about them and that I can just shake it off. Yep, nothing says your opinion doesn't matter to me like putting a considerable amount of effort into creating something to tell them that. With Taylor Swift's Shake It Off, she attempts to address everyone talking shit about her personal life. I go on too many dates, but I can't make them stay. At least that's what people say. That's what people say. Actually, Taylor, people just say you write too many songs about your dates. No one cares about your personal life. They just wish you'd grow up and start singing about something other than the dozen or so boys who broke your heart. And Demi Lovato enters Taylor Swift territory by writing a song about how she shouldn't write songs about boys. I can't believe I ever stayed up writing songs about you. You don't deserve to know the way I used to think about you. Oh no, not anymore. Oh no, not anymore. Oh no, not anymore? Then what the fuck is this? It appears to be a song you wrote about him. Oh wait, no, this is the last one, right? It's the last one until the next one, because this shit sells to sad little teenage girls who believe the world is over when the guy they dated for like 2 weeks makes out with some other skank at a party, so they go home and listen to this to make themselves feel better. My ex-man brought his new girlfriend. She's like, oh my god, I'm just gonna shake. Taylor almost wrote a song without making a reference to an ex-boyfriend, assuming you don't count the part where she's technically talking about the critics and not the exes. But she just couldn't resist throwing a little white girl rapping in there to tell you that she doesn't care. Honestly, she doesn't. Not at all. Oh god, why did he bring her? Why? Why? I know, I'm gonna write a song about how much I don't care. Great going, ladies. I can't wait for your next songs about how you don't care that your music made a list of the 10 worst songs of the year. Number 7, Meghan Trainor. All about that bass. Because you know I'm all about that bass, no trouble. I'm all about that bass, no trouble. Poor Meghan Trainor. She's so sick of people overanalyzing this song and claiming she's skinny shaming because of her referring to skinny bitches and then saying, I'm just playing. Well, I'll tell you what. I did enough of that in my dose earlier in the year, so let's not focus on the multiple times you skinny shame in the song. Not just the one line like you and the defenders claim. Let's just talk about how fucking stupid the song is in general. First off, it's not 1960, and it's not even at a time when 1960 is popular again. This doo-wop revival shit mixed with modern white girl rapping is fucking terrible. Second, the song title itself doesn't even make any goddamn sense. You're all about that bass, no treble? What does that mean in relation to the rest of the song? I assume you believe this to be a clever metaphor, bass representing fat, treble representing skinny, which, fine. But if you're gonna use this metaphor, maybe include more bass than just a drowned out bass line. Taken literally, the song seems to have plenty of treble, including your nasally garbled voice, so clearly you're okay with some treble. And let's talk about this. Oh, I love this attitude. If you're not into big girls, just move along. Like a guy is gonna come up and say, oh shit, I'm sorry, I thought you were just wearing a really big coat. You're a fat girl, never mind. It's not exactly hidden. You don't really have to tell a guy, if you don't like big girls, get the fuck out of here. Plus, it makes you seem super aggressive right off the bat, so even if a guy is into bigger girls, they're gonna wanna get the fuck away from you in a hurry because you're probably also one of those girls who have posted a If you can't handle me at my worst, you don't deserve me at my best Facebook posts, and you're a hyper bitch. And this song is just pandering anyway. The song isn't made with the best intentions of trying to teach larger girls that they're accepted, or to teach skinny people that large people are fine. It was made to sell to an American market where one-third of people are obese, and a good chunk of the other two-thirds are well on their way. This isn't made to boost your confidence, big girls. It was made to boost sales to a previously untapped market. It's not good enough to just promote a pop singer who happens to be overweight, singing about all the same shit regular pop singers do. They gotta drive it home with lyrics about how great it is to be big. Well, drive it home right after a quick trip through the drive-thru. Number 6. Trey Songz, Smartphones. She picks up the phone, in my head I know I'm wrong, I just wanna know what she's heard. The video that goes along with this explains it a little bit better, but here's what's going on. She picks up the phone, and Trey Songz is a little worried about what she has heard. Presumably, Trey's girlfriend, wife, whatever, has answered her phone, only to hear, well, what? Something that's got Trey a little worried. Let's find out. I'm pacing back and forth, cause I know that I've been caught, trying to think of the perfect words. He's been caught, and he's fucking worried. So it doesn't take the fuckers from True Detective to figure this out. He was having sex with someone else, pocket dialed a significant other, and now he's fucked. This is also confirmed later by this line. So, what's he gonna do to make it better? Be a man? Explain himself? Ask for forgiveness even though he knows he doesn't deserve it? So I can come to her and lie right to her face. I don't know what I'm gonna say, but I know that I'm gonna say whatever it takes. Lie. Right to her face. Make up any fucking story he can. If the only thing I judge songs on was the message, this right here is the worst fucking song of the year. Maybe the worst fucking song of the decade. Video over. This song is literally about getting caught cheating and then lying to cover it up. No remorse or regret for the person he's fucked over. He's only upset that he was caught. It didn't mean nothing. To you? This is a fucking ridiculous excuse for cheating. Yeah, you treat women like objects, just living fleshlights that don't mean nothing. So that's supposed to make your actual girlfriend, your wife, whatever, feel okay? She's waving goodbye, goodbye. Smartphones, dumb shit. It almost sounds like he's blaming the phone for the fact that he's a complete piece of shit. Like this is a cautionary tale for shitty men who want to cheat on someone. Don't be like this. Turn your stupid phone off so you can do all the fucking you want without getting caught. Not. Don't cheat on your girl, just make sure when you do it, make sure she can't find out. What a fucking scumbag. People like this deserve to get a special kind of AIDS that can't be treated, can't be transmitted to decent human beings, and kills them even more slowly and more painfully than regular AIDS. Number 5. Jennifer Lopez featuring Iggy Azalea, Booty. Big, big booty, what you got a big booty. Ooh. Another year, another song about big asses. No subtlety, no innuendo, no deeper meaning. It's a song about having a big ass. Period. It's not clever in the way it presents it. It's just two girls with big asses talking about how they have big asses. If I can give it points for anything, at least Iggy Azalea is rapping about something that's actually true about herself. Instead of just rapping in her ridiculously fake, dirty South accent about being a hood bitch. But that's me being as generous as possible. They're begging me to drop down on them, but right now we be on the top. The last time the world seen the booty this good, it was on Jenny from the block. Oh, are Iggy Azalea and Jennifer Lopez in this? Gee, I wouldn't have known if they didn't tell me somewhere in the fucking song. And I feel like I'm starting to get repetitive by talking about this, but this song is so fucking repetitive. The word booty is said at least 43 times. You know when you see, hear, or say a word too many times that it stops being a word? Booty. 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 It just sounds like a noise to me, devoid of any meaning at this point. Also, I'm sorry, I'm a straight man, and I like women of many shapes and sizes, but the video for this song was just fucking gross. Two sweaty women pushing their asses together is not attractive, I don't care who's doing it. Now, I know Jennifer Lopez's music has been pretty lackluster in the past anyway, but after this, how can anyone take her seriously as a judge on anything? She's telling people whether or not they have talent? You did a song where you just said booty for 4 minutes and rubbed your ass on another woman. I know people say I shouldn't be talking shit when I can't sing, but there's a huge difference. I don't get fucking paid to do it. She does. Her telling singers they suck would be like Tara Reid and Tom Green deciding who should and shouldn't be actors. Number 4, Ray Schrimmer, No Flex Zone.
No flex zone. No flex zone. They know better. They know better.
Well, this is my fault. I should have known better than to listen to a song called No Flex Zone, so this is my punishment. Ray Schrimmer is a rap duo consisting of two guys that you'll never hear from again, so don't worry about learning their actual names because it just means you might miss them when they're gone, like why farmers don't name cows. But this means they chose this name for their group. On purpose. Their website says this mess that looks like it should be pronounced Ray Schremmered is actually pronounced Ray Schrimmer. When you need to put a pronunciation key on your website for a name that you made up, you made up a shitty name. Let's hear some rapping from Ray Schrimmer guy number 1.
Sway, lean, lean, sway, it's the same difference. H2O, lean, same thing.
No, I'm pretty sure that water and lean are two very different things. You should consult your doctor before drinking 8 glasses of lean per day.
Niggas throw sets in gangbang. Free everybody in a chain gang. Been 2 days since I laid down. Two more D5 chains on. Mr. T, them rains on.
Okay, does anyone know what this song is about? Because I fucking don't. He's all over the place here. First, decreeing that water is the same as Sprite and cough syrup mixed together. Then he's engaging in some gang violence. Or group sex, I'm not sure. Then he wants everyone in prison released. Then he's really tired. Then he's referencing jewelry worn by famous people. This is just some nonsensical assortment of rap cliches fired off one after another. Now, given my knowledge of gangsta to English, flexing is very similar to peacocking. Showing off, appearing to be better than others in various ways. So, if this was the No Flex Zone, one might believe that this song is supposed to be about not bragging and not talking about how much better you are, right? So, Ray Schrimmer guy number 2, please, put this song back on course.
Young niggas gotta get to the money. 5 chains so they look at me funny.
Yes, young African Americans do believe they need to get to the money when every song increases the amount of fucking chains that are in fashion. One was fine, then you needed 2, now it's 5. Inflation's hit the fucking ghetto hard.
Showed up with the juice of the troops. Rollin' 7 every time I shoot. She said, why you got so many condoms with you? I say I'm a player, to be honest with you.
I don't know about you, but this all sounds like flexing to me. Showed up with his troops, his boys, he always wins at dice, he fucks a lot of bitches, wears a lot of chains.
We shopping good up on an island.
An island. Not bragging, but due to the enormous amount of wealth I've amassed, I could purchase an island where one for sale at the mall. I was waiting for the part where there's some redemption, like they say, but we don't need all that shit. Or giving some sort of indication that this is supposed to be some sort of parody of rappers who act like this, but that they don't flex and that this is the No Flex Zone. But that never happens. Apparently this song's actually the No Flex Zone for everyone but Ray Schrimmer, who can flex all they want, but that's not a very snappy title. Plus, we get more first-time rappers that no one's ever heard of telling us how rich they are. Just what music needed. Hey, rappers, here's a challenge for 2015. Make a song where you don't tell us that you have more money than us. We know. We got it. Good for you. Move the fuck on. Number 3. Nicki Minaj, Anaconda.
Now that's real, real, real. Gun in my purse, bitch, I can't.
Sometimes a song is so hated by everyone else that I don't even want to put it on this list. Call me a hipster of hate, but I'm sick of hearing about Anaconda. I almost wanted to lump it in with the other too mediocre to make the list songs, but then as I heard it more and more, I realized something. This song is actually a perfect shitstorm, blending every bad rap and hip-hop cliche with every awful Nicki Minaj staple. Let's go through the list. First, the rap cliches. Sampling of a very well-known song.
My anaconda don't, my anaconda don't, my anaconda don't want none unless you got buns, hun.
Man, with the royalties he'll make off of this, Sir Mix-a-Lot's eaten both lunch and dinner today. So, check. Not quite rhyming lyrics about material possessions, drugs, and or violence?
Boy, Sway named Troy, used to live in Detroit. Bitch, dope, stealing money, he was getting some coins. Was in shootouts with the law, but he lived in a palace. Bought me Alexander McQueen, he was keeping me stylish.
Check, 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 and check. Now the Nicki Minaj-specific conventions. Making nonsensical noises instead of saying words?
So I pulled up in the Jag Mayweather with the jab like dun 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 dun.
Not sure how one does something like dun 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 dun, but check. Nicki mistaking female empowerment for just being a hoe?
Real country ass nigga, let me play with his rifle. Pussy put his ass to sleep, now we calling me NyQuil. Come through and fuck him in my automobile, let him eat it with his grill, so keep telling me to chill.
Fuck, we're on a roll. And finally, do we have her stretching out a word for a long time?
I'm on some dumb shit. By the way, what'd he say? He can tell.
It's the entire fucking list. All right, everyone. Let's head to the bonus round. She's managed to hit all of the regular bad rap cliches and all the stuff that makes Nicki Minaj particularly bad. But we've heard all of these before. What else can you give us, Nicki? Brilliant. The skinny shaming is the new fat shaming trend in an excruciatingly annoying screech pulled off by a woman who very clearly isn't plus sized except in the chest and ass region. Man, when Tony Hawk landed the 900 in competition, people said, where can he go from here? When Nicki Minaj put out Stupid Ho, I thought, how much more annoying can she get? Well, Tony Hawk never surpassed the 900, but ladies and gentlemen, Nicki Minaj has managed the impossible and outdid herself. Congratulations, Nicki. You're even shittier than last year. We wait, worried and fearful, to find out what fresh hell you'll unleash upon the world with your next release. Number 2. Psy, featuring Snoop Dogg. Hangover.
Hangover, 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 hangover. Party's over, it ain't over. Try to make a back of memory over and over.
Sigh, you got off lucky last year. I have a rule with this list. No viral songs. If a song is only well known because it's an internet meme, it doesn't get on the list. It's why Friday wasn't on here, or any of the other Arc music shit for that matter. It's why Ilvis the Fox wasn't on this list. And it's why Gangnam Style didn't make this list last year. This year, it's different. Psy, or probably more likely the American record label that signed him after he went viral, released this 5-minute abomination in North America to try and capitalize on the success of Gangnam Style. 2.1 billion views, many of those American. So it stands to reason there's money to be made off of Psy in the US, right? Well, guess again. As I predicted, it was the Macarena of the 2010s, a foreign language song that only became popular because of a stupid dance and a silly video, not because anyone was interested in the musical talent of Psy. Here to try and help sell it to us dumb round eyes is Snoop Dogg, who will appear on any song for money.
Drink till you're drunk, smoke like a broke stove. Don't quit, take flight, I can't remember last night.
I've enjoyed a Snoop song or two over the years, but don't fucking try and defend him. He was on a big time Rush song once. He'll do anything for the paycheck. This song is the musical equivalent of a hangover. Headache inducing, every second of it feels like an hour. You just wish it would end, but it seems to go on for fucking ever.
Hangover, hangover, hangover. Hangover, 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 hangover.
And just when you think you're through the worst of it, it somehow manages to make you feel even worse. Sorry, Psy. Your 15 minutes of fame are up here. North Americans get bored easily. We saw a wacky Korean video, Ellen did the dance, everyone had a good laugh. But none of this will translate into ongoing success here. Just slowly declining sales and interest until Universal realizes that Americans are only interested in watching a clown dance, but not interested in buying the music he's dancing to. And you'll get dropped from their label. Lucky for you, you still have a country with 50 million people in it that like you for you, and don't see you as some sort of novelty. I hope. Otherwise, this must be a very depressing day for you. And the worst song of 2014 is Avril Lavigne, Hello Kitty.
Mina Seiko Arigato, kawaii.
Somewhere a Japanese person is cringing at the butchering of their language. Arigato, kawaii. She sounds like one of the girls from Baby Metal had a stroke. Oh, Avril. Why'd you have to go and make things so complicated? You used to be the princess of pop punk, a mildly welcome diversion in the early 2000s for teenagers from all the shitty girl groups and boy bands while still being marketable enough to make money. Then you put out Girlfriend and realized that being the voice of the disenfranchised doesn't make as much money as singing about vacuous bullshit like trying to steal a guy from someone else or how a guy makes you feel so hot. And here we are now, you're 30, and you're still trying to pretend to be a cutesy 18-year-old. Which is funny, because when you were 18, you were trying to pretend you were a mature adult. This song is the culmination of a career of garbage. Easily the most annoying song of 2014, with treats like dubstep for no reason other than it's popular right now. Squealing the last line of each stanza. Slumber party like a fat kid on a pack of Smarties. What does that even mean? Like, quickly and with a bit of shame and self-loathing? And speaking of nonsense, stupid lyrics that are made even more ridiculous by the fact that a 30-year-old is singing them. Still live with your mom, do you, Avril? Spin the bottle. At 30. And easily the most repetitive and mind-numbing chorus of the year that doesn't even have anything to do with the fucking song. To the two or three brain-dead assholes that would defend this song and say, yeah, it has everything to do with the song. She's talking about having a boy over, and then this part's a sexual double entendre. The only time I've ever heard kitty used as a sexual innuendo is as a slang for vagina. So, she thinks her vagina is pretty and doesn't want it to leave her? No, it's just some fucking nonsense she threw in a song because the only place she's popular anymore is Japan, and Hello Kitty's popular in Japan. So she figured if she referenced something Japanese, people would buy the song. A lot of people accused her of being racist when the video came out, which just depicts her acting like a fucking spaz in Japan, while enforcing stereotypes by making all the backup dancers look alike, and showing a bunch of very stereotypical things. But I'll defend her here. She wasn't being racist, she didn't hate them, even though I could see why someone could think that if she released this over there to torture them with. She just knows that this is all North Americans know about Japanese culture. Sushi and schoolgirls and Hello Kitty. So she's just playing to that. It's not Avril's job to educate society, and the day it becomes her job is the day that we're all fucked. I guess this is what happens, though, when Chad Kroeger and Avril Lavigne work together. Thankfully, they haven't had a kid yet. Can you imagine what the spawn of those two would have created? It'd be more horrifying than a horde of directioners surrounding you, and you're holding a single signed photo of a shirtless Nile. Hey, by the way, if that ever does happen and you have a gun, save one bullet for yourself. So there it is. 2014's worst of the worst. Honorable mentions go out to Katy Perry's This Is How We Do, just for this line.
Shout out to all you kids buying bottle service with your rent money! Respect!
Yep, encouraging people to go into debt to party. Going so far as to respect it. Well done, you dumb cunt. Charlie XCX's Break the Rules, where she basically makes an even shittier version of the Ramones' Rock and Roll High School. Nickelback's Edge of a Revolution, because it's just too funny that a band so afraid to deviate from the usual Nickelback formula of mainstream rock is singing about revolution. And Bobby Shmurda's Hot Nigga, because it's a song named and containing the lyrics, Hot Nigga. All right, Avril, you otaku, you. Dubstep us out.